Before you buy any industrial blast pot, or even rent one, it might be a good idea to watch this video. We'll explain why the cheapest blast pot is usually the most costly choice. Coming up next. Hello and welcome to this week's Primed Insight. Today we'll share our know-how on the most critical considerations when buying or even renting an industrial blast pot. Now, this insight is for professional sandblasters, not hobbyists. The tips we're providing are based on these upfront assumptions. This pot is a professional tool to increase your productivity and profitability, and you don't want to pay more than you should. If that describes you, we're going to provide a checklist to help you select the perfect pot for your particular application. This insight will save you lots of time, money, and headaches down the road. So let's jump right in. Now, most people think that this is what you're buying when you purchase a blast pot. I mean, it certainly appears to be a blast pot, but a blast pot is more than just a vessel holding your abrasive. It's more than just a container. If it were only a vessel, it would be very simple to buy the right pot. You'd compare size and price across the board, and then simply choose the lowest price. Here's an analogy as to why that's a bad strategy. Let's pretend you make your money as a taxi or Uber driver. Now, would you buy this car from your local dealership? Now, from a container perspective, it holds 4 passengers and it's most likely the cheapest car on the market. Of course you wouldn't waste your money. That's not a car. It's a frame. It can't even provide the most minimal outcome you need, which is movement and transportation. Likewise, as a professional blaster, the most minimal outcome you need from your pot is not storage, but conveyance. The movement and transportation of abrasive from the vessel into the hose and out the nozzle. The perfect industrial blast pot will provide 3 key benefits: efficient abrasive delivery, low maintenance and repair costs, and pressure efficiency. Now, these 3 benefits will determine your productivity, profitability, and ROI on the blast pot. And from here forward, we'll be discussing which blast pot features maximize each of these benefits. But first, let's just establish as tip number 1 this fundamental idea. When pricing a blast pot, think of it as buying the valves and plumbing more so than the vessel. You know, just like a car where the engine, transmission, and drive shaft determine speed, fuel efficiency, and future maintenance and repair, a blast pot's results depend mostly on its valves and plumbing. Size is important, and we'll discuss that in a moment, but your productivity and profitability are based on these 3 metrics, which are primarily the result of your valves and plumbing. So with that being said, let's focus on the number 1 valve to evaluate before making your purchase. Tip number 2, choosing the right abrasive metering valve. Now, the most important valve to consider is the abrasive metering valve. It can and will affect all 3 of these metrics, and so therefore, pay attention to what is installed on the pot you buy. This may be your most critical choice for your success. A really cheap blast pot costs less because it'll have a really cheap metering valve, and a cheap metering valve will burn through your abrasive much faster. Here are some fairly common conveyances of abrasive through blast pots per hour. A cheap metering valve on its own can be expected to waste roughly 5% of the abrasive that flows through it. So in 1 year's time, operating these pots at 6 hours a day, this is the abrasive you can expect to waste by saving money with the cheap metering valve. Now, those figures are per year, and your blast pot should be at least a 10-year investment. Hopefully you can now see how the cheapest price upfront can easily become the costliest decision on the back end. And that's only calculating wasted abrasive. Burning through abrasive also results in your operators needing to stop and refill the pot more often. And this refill process usually becomes an hourly 10 to 15 minute ritual of unproductive labor time, costing you money. In a 10-hour day, that's almost 2.5 hours of lost productivity. And also, using extra abrasive will also mean more cleanup time, which, you guessed it, costs you money. And finally, a cheap valve burning through abrasive will eventually require more replacement parts and maintenance. And this can realistically cost several $1,000s per year. And if your metering valve were to break down during your project for, let's say, hours or even a day or more, what's the value of that lost time? Now, full disclosure, we only sell Axiom Schmidt blast pots. Now, we're not claiming they're perfect, but from our nearly 50 years experience, they're the best in the market. And here's just one of the reasons why. A standard inlet-outlet pot from competing brands will require around $2,000 worth of spare parts per year. Replacing these valves every 1.5 to 2 months is the industry norm. Now, knockoff pots that try and copy the Schmidt valves are longer lasting than the inlet-outlet competitors. However, due to lower production quality, you are still spending about $1,200 per year on spare parts and replacement valves. The lowest maintenance blast pots are the Schmidt brand that we sell. Your abrasive metering valve is the precision instrument on your blast pot. It's worth the extra few hundred dollars up front. Now, tip number three, pressure efficiency addresses another important consideration when buying or renting a blast pot. There are two styles of blast pots. We have pressure release and pressure hold. A pressure release system acts in the following manner. When the dead man attached to your blast hose is activated, it sends a signal to pressurize the pot and convey abrasive into the hose and out the nozzle. Each time you release the dead man, it signals the pot to release the pressure into the air. The critical thing here to understand is that the pot needs to repressurize each time you depress the dead man. Now, even if pressurization only takes a few seconds, you can imagine how much time is chipped away over the course of a day, a week, or several weeks. Now, a pressure hold system maintains pot pressure and doesn't depressurize when you release the dead man. As soon as you depress the dead man trigger again, the blast hose is energized and the metering valve opens to release the flow of abrasive in less than 2 seconds. If you are doing blasting work that requires spot blasting or constant stop, start, moving about, you'll save about 5 to 10% of your abrasive cost by using a pressure hold system. In fact, we recommend that all industrial blasters use pressure hold. It's faster and saves abrasive. Okay, so what determines if the blast pot is pressure hold or pressure release? Surprise, it's our old friend, the abrasive metering valve again. The valve you purchase even determines what style pot you'll be using from here forward. And in our experience, there are really only two reasons you should ever consider buying a pressure release blast pot. Number one, you have an automatic overhead feed of abrasive into the pot, which means when the pot depressurizes, gravity feeds that abrasive into the vessel, preventing those typical 10 to 15 minute labor breaks used to refill the pot. Also, a pressure release metering valve costs less than pressure hold, so this may depend on your budget. Pressure efficiency also depends on maintaining optimal pressure. Any restrictions will negatively affect your blasting speed. On a blast pot, a component that can choke this pressure is the bore piping. These come in different diameters. Here's our advice. For an industrial blast pot, you want a minimum of 1 1/4 inch piping. Make sure this is the minimum. If you're going to be blasting with a number 7 or 8 blast nozzle, you want to upgrade this to 1 1/2 inch piping. This allows you to maximize your pressure, getting more done faster. And finally, with such a variety of pot sizes, we would never say size doesn't matter. Tip number four, size matters. There are two main considerations for choosing pot size, abrasive capacity and portability. The size of the blast pot impacts how long the blast pot will last before you have to stop and refill your abrasive. Now, ideally, this would be sized to ensure refills are few and far between. For example, if you're blasting a large tank, you don't want to have to stop to refill ever, so you'd want a bulk blaster. But if your budget and transport options don't allow for that, you want the largest pot that will suit your needs. Of course, you may be involved with a variety of blasting scenarios, and in that case, our recommendation is to choose the pot that will work for 80% of your projects. In a blast room situation, you want to size the pot so the blaster can refill during normal breaks. So, you know, if the blaster needs to break every 1.5 hours for a convenience break, get a pot that will last that long. The other impact of size is portability. If you're needing a blast pot setup that allows you to go up a man lift or haul around in the back of a pickup truck, then a smaller size is what you need. If you don't have the right pot for a future project, you can always rent. So that's the best professional advice we can offer in this brief video. We hope it helps clarify a few issues and saves you time, money, and headaches down the road. However, if you still have questions, don't hesitate to contact our knowledgeable, friendly staff whose entire purpose is to answer your questions and help you make the best choices for your business. Give us a call. Thanks for watching this week's Primed Insight. We'll see you next time.